إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تبارك وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. نسأل الله العزيز الغفار أن يجيرنا وإياكم من عذاب النار. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ni'mah of Islam. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep you and I steadfast on this ni'mah. A quick note inshaAllah ta'ala before I continue with the explanation of the hadith of Abu Kabsha al-Mali radiallahu anhu. Earlier today, after the khutbah, and in which I spoke about the phenomenon of death and subhanAllah the way that we are supposed to deal with it, and it being a reminder that we have to change things, subhanAllah. And I was really surprised and disappointed today, subhanAllah, from over 400 people in attendance, we only had 4 people go to the burial of that brother today. And subhanAllah, I mean, this is from a few facets. First one, of course, vis-a-vis your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially after having heard, and I'm talking in general, I'm not talking about the attendance here, I'm talking in general. This way, it's a reality check for all of us to see what's the condition of our ummah, or what is the condition of our community. SubhanAllah, after we talked about death in a khutbah of Jumu'ah, and then we have out of 400 people, only 4 people show up to the burial. I mean, SubhanAllah, this is what, when it comes to the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also, we are representing our masjid to those people that came from, other places, and some of them are Christians. It was a good opportunity for da'wah for all of us, subhanAllah. But when they come and they see that, knowing full well how full the masjid was of people, and then there are only 4 people to bury the brother, and subhanAllah, we did not really make a strong case for Islam today. We did not make a strong case for the spreading of our deen, and we should, and start with myself, subhanAllah, we should make more of the effort when it comes to that. And we have to remind ourselves that on the day of reckoning, the one hasan, if I smile at this brother, show him that I love him for the sake of Allah, that's one hasana. Allah multiplies it by 10 to 700 to infinity. But there will come a day when one hasana will make a difference between you being from the ones that succeed, at least in the scale, in the mawazin, in that phase, at least you succeed from that, and you pass that stage in order to cross the salat, and maybe you have a chance of being from the people of Al-Jannah. One hasana can hold you back. One. And good luck. Good luck finding that hasana. Your father is not going to give it to you. Your wife is not going to give it to you. Your children are not going to give it to you. Your mom is not going to give it. Nobody. Nobody, because everyone is suffering from the same thing. Hasana deficiency. Everyone is seeking to have enough to be able to, subhanAllah, not be doomed, not be from the people of the hellfire. But yet, We turn our backs on a mountain of hasanat that the Prophet promised us. Wallahi, it is something, it is a commodity that we cannot afford. If you were told that if you drive about 15, 20 miles, you'll find someone waiting for you to hand you a check for $1 million. I mean, subhanAllah, I don't care if you drive in a Geo Metro, you make it go 200 miles an hour to get there first. That's the way it is. But this is exactly the point. When it comes to the things of the dunya, we are always the first ones to rush in and try to be there first and try to get it done. But when it comes to al-akhirah, it's okay. I've done enough. Allah is merciful. You know, I'll get it the next time. What if there's no next time? That's why the Sahaba, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them, the way they dealt with this issue of hasanat and sayyiat, they treat every minute as if it is their last. So when it comes to any act of worship, any act of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they want to take advantage of it to the fullest, do it the best way that they can, because they don't have any guarantee that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would allow them to live few more minutes or few more hours or few more days to do things differently, to do things better. They want to do it better now. And that's subhanAllah, that is the reason why Allah honored them. And that is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave strength to this ummah. This ummah was an honored ummah amongst the other nations. And subhanAllah, the other nations, they used to send people to learn from the Muslims in Andalusia and in Baghdad and other places. These are the places of knowledge. SubhanAllah, a person that wanted to buy something of quality, it was all well known in all of Europe. You have to travel to the Muslim world. Quality and knowledge exists and strength is there. But subhanAllah, as Umar radiallahu anhu said, we were a people that were humiliated, meaning that we had no importance. There was the Romans, there was the Persians, there was these great superpowers, and there was the Arabs. Who are they? They're nobody. They're for the forgotten people, subhanAllah. First day that they were knocking on the door of the Emperor of Persia, he said, who are these people here? He's still arrogant, he doesn't get it yet. He said, these are the Arabs. What do you want? Well, they're here to conquer. Excuse me? I'll give him some old clothes and tell him to get out of here. This is how they're dealing with this matter, not taking it seriously. SubhanAllah. So Umar said, we were people that were humiliated. They wouldn't have any weight, subhanAllah, in the global scheme of nations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored us with our power, our strength, our beauty, Allah honored us with Islam. And every single time we try to seek honor in anything besides Islam, what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliated us. This is the way it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach us to better handle these situations and take advantage of them and not let them go to waste. Of course, the ones that had to go to work and of course, I mean, but subhanAllah, for someone that did not have to go do anything, he did not do the extra effort to gain these hasanat, subhanAllah, he is the only one who will be regretful on the day of reckoning. Going back to our hadith that we are in the process of explaining, subhanAllah, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم حديث أبو كبش الأماري قال صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاثة أقسم عليهم وأحدثكم حديثا فاحفظوه. Three things that I swear an oath upon, and I tell you some words, I will tell you some words that you should commit to memory. ما نقص مال من صدقة ما نقص مال من صدقة that the wealth will never decrease when you give charity, when you give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولا ظلم عبد مظلمة فصبر عليها إلا زاده الله عزة. There's not a servant that is patient after being oppressed except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase him in honor. ولا فتح باب ولا فتح عبد باب مسألة إلا فتح الله عليه باب فخر. There's not a person that starts asking from people instead of asking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or begging for things except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open for him a door of poverty. ثم قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الدنيا لأربعة نفر. Verily the life of this world is for four types of people. عبد رزق الله مالا وعلما فهو يتقي فيه ربه ويصل فيه رحمه ويعلم لله فيه حقا. This man that was given, the first type, man was given wealth and he was given knowledge, and he, with his wealth, the wealth that Allah has given him, he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has piety for Allah in that wealth, and he helps the people of his kinship, the people of his family, he joins the ties of his kinship through that wealth, and he knows the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over that wealth or in that wealth. فهذا بأفضل المنازل. This one is in the best of positions. وعبد رزقه الله علما ولم يرزقه مالا. And a servant that was given knowledge but he was not given wealth. And he is truthful. وهو صادق في نيته أو صادق النية. He is truthful in his intention. He said, يقول لو أن لي مالا لعملت بعمل فلان فهو بنيته فأجرهما سواء. He is truthful in his intention. He says that if Allah was to give me wealth, then I would do exactly like so and so is doing. His with his intention, they get the same reward. وعبد الثالث, the third one. وعبد رزقه الله مالا ولم يرزقه علما فهو يخبط في ماله بغير علم لا يتقي فيه ربه ولا يصل فيه رحمه ولا يعلم لله فيه حقا. And the third category, a person that was given wealth but no knowledge, and subhanAllah, he squanders that wealth without any knowledge. He does not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that he spends it. He does not bring the ties of his family, the ties of his kinship together with that wealth. He does not know the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that wealth. And فهذا بأخبث المنازل. This one is in the most despicable of situations. وعبد, the fourth one, الرابع, وعبد لم يؤتي الله تعالى مالا ولا علما فيقول لو أن لي مالا لعملت بعمل فلان فهو بنيته فهما في الوزر سواء. And the fourth category, a person that Allah neither gave him wealth nor gave him knowledge, he says that if I was to have any wealth, I will do exactly like so and so is doing. The third one, he with his intention, they get the same wisdom, they will get the same level of transgression law against them in their records. And I started in explaining a little bit about the importance of sadaqah. We were spending a little time in that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged the believing servants, besides giving the zakah that is mandatory, to give for his sake subhanahu wa ta'ala, having promised them that will never decrease their wealth. And we said that literally, if you were to do the math and say you have $1,000 and you give $300 for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now the math of this dunya says that you have $700 left, but the math of Allah is different. It says that you literally still have $1,000. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace it many folds over, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it a bounty that waits for you in the hereafter. You will find it as mountains and mountains of hasanat, as we will see inshaAllah ta'ala. Allah ta'ala qala ta'ala وَأَنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. وهذه أنزلت, قيل أنها أنزلت في الإنفاق في سبيل الله, وقيل أنها أنزلت في الجهاد في سبيل الله, أن من لا يجاهد في سبيل الله فهو يلقي بيده إلى التهلكة. It was said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and give for the sake of Allah, and do not throw yourselves, do not cause yourselves doom, and do righteous deeds. For verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the righteous ones. And this is, like I said, according to some scholars of tafsir, said it talks about giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and others say that it is this ayah was revealed in talking about striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا أنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي يوم لا بيع فيه ولا خلة ولا شفاعة. الله تعالى said, oh you who believe, give for the sake of Allah before a day will come where there will be no bayr, no trade. Remember, this is a trade. Whatever you give for the sake of Allah, هذه تجارة مع الله تعالى. This is a trade with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You give from what He bestowed upon you in the first place, and in return He subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised to reward you in this life and in the hereafter. So you give for the sake of Allah before there is any trade. There'll be no time for that anymore. And there will be no khulla. There will be no relationship of friendship, a person that could be there to help you. There's none of that anymore. وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. There will be no intercession anymore. SubhanAllah. And obviously, these are things that will be difficult to endure for most people. Might as well get ready for it. قَالَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَنْ تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِ عَلِيمٌ. Allah Ta'ala said, لَنْ تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ. You will not reach that level of righteousness, of purity, of being a good believer, until you give from that which you love. And subhanAllah, and whatever you give for Allah, for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it best. Now who can tell me the story, the Sahabi that has a story associated with this ayah? There's a Sahabi that heard this ayah and he did something. Who can tell me?
Pomegranates?
No, Abdullah ibn Mubarak is another. Al-Mubarak is another thing.
Is it
about that? Many
Sahabi, he had a garden?
Yeah, not so. I don't know. Huh? No.
Did he give away his garden?
Yes. But what's his name?
Abu Dahba? Abu Dahba?
A man who was the stepfather of Anas, the husband of Umm Sulaym, Abu Talha al-Ansari. Abu Talha al-Ansari had a garden by the name of Al-Bayruha. Hey, but this is Hajjat al-Sawr. فأبو الدحداح قصة أبو الدحداح في من الذي يقبل الله قرضا حسنا, هذه الآية. ولكن هذه أبو طلحة الأنصاري أن تنالوا البر. When he heard this ayah, he came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, يا رسول الله, Allah تعالى is telling us that you will not attain righteousness, true righteousness, until you give from that which you love. And the most beloved of all my wealth and all my money is a bustan. What is a bustan? Al-Ha'iq. This is a piece of land that has over 3,000 palm trees. It's a, basically a fortune. And this is, he said, this is the most beloved, this is the most beloved to me of all my money. And I want to give it for the sake of Allah, because I want to attain al-birr, as Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran. Subhanallah. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَدَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بَخِن بَخِن Ya Allah. How do we translate this one? How do we possibly translate this? Bakhin, bakhin. I just leave it alone. That's beyond congratulations. Like, it's a way of saying, you know, the words are not enough to tell you what you just did for yourself and for your akhirah. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, this hada malun rabih. This is a good transaction. This is a winning transaction. He said, but make that a sadaqah towards the people of your kingship, of your family, of your cousins and your close family members. Subhanallah. So it's end up being two things. Sadaqah, three things. Give it for the sake of Allah. Give it from that which you love. Subhanallah. So give it a fortune, and then give it to the people of your kingship. SubhanAllah. This is the way that the Sahaba, and of course there are many like Abu Dahdah, Allah Ta'ala said, وَمَنْ الَّذِي يَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ قَالَ الْحَسَنَ Who would give Allah a loan? Imagine Allah is telling you and I, who would give Allah a loan? Does Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala need a loan like the Jews said? Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is ghani, self-sufficient. But look at this, He's given you in the first place. If it wasn't for Him, you would have nothing. You would not have a dime to your name. Then He said, hey, I mean, to encourage you, give me a loan. Give me a loan from that which I gave you in the first place, and you will see what I will do. You will see how I will return this loan, subhanAllah. And then Abu Dahdah, as the brother mentioned, he heard this and he said, Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, He's asking us for a loan? He wants a loan from us? Ya Rasulullah, bear witness that I've given. أَقْرَبْتُ حَائِقِ رَبِّي تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى I give my whole bustan haiq. Same thing, a land with thousands of palm trees as a loan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he goes up, he goes to his bustan. He finds al-Dahdah, his wife, eating from the dates and giving her children. He said, Ya Umm al-Dahdah, take the children out and get out of there. She said, why? He said, I have given this haid to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have loaned this haid to Allah. Do you know what she did? Did she start screaming, pulling her hair? You bankrupted us. You this, you that. I want a divorce. I'm not going to let it happen. Subhanallah. What did she say? Rabih al-bay'. Rabih al-bay'. Rabih al-bay'. Subhanallah. This is a winning transaction. And then she started going with her kids. Kicking them. Or hitting the dates from their hands in their mouths. Drop it. That's it. It's not ours anymore. It belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she got out. These are the Sahaba. These are the Sahaba. But on the other hand, I'll give you one example. I was in this masjid giving a khutbah, and I'm not going to mention which masjid. And they started announcing, they told me to announce or to encourage people to give for this lady who was a single mother with four kids. She's 5 days late for her rent and she's being evicted. And we need to collect probably about, you know, $1,200 for the rent and maybe a little bit more to help her out. Then this really wealthy guy that I know has all types of businesses, very successful. He comes to me, he's all proud, puts his hand in his pocket, he takes out. How do I say, Rasma? Yeah, we're talking about شكيف تقولوها بالله ها؟ يعني شو بيسموها بفلسطين ها؟ فلسطين بالفلسطيني ها كمشة وفي مصر ها
كمشة
ها رزمة أيوة رزمة من رزمة اللي هي يعني ها رزمة اللي يعني بالي بالي يعني fist full of money big all hundreds said ما شاء الله اتحلت this is the solution for our problem الحمد لله I guess I spoke too soon. He started going through it and going through it and going through it quickly. Like, why is he going to give all this? Then he reaches in, $5. There you go. This, yes, yeah, this is for the lady that needs rent, okay? All right? MashaAllah, Allah, Jazakallah. Can I give you a hug? SubhanAllah.
Are you kidding me?
By saying, can I give you a hug? What I really meant is, can I choke you? Because I really wanted to choke. They were all hundreds, but he was going through them quickly. MashaAllah, technique, you know, very, very, very fast going through that thing. He's used to, he's used to. Yes, he ate the rosa, yeah.
Oh my God.
Huh? Bills like a quarter of a you know Egyptian pound or quarter of an Egyptian pound would not even buy you a sip of water this big you know so that's the people from Egypt that tell you but people this is what they're giving for Sadaqah but they found another one that's a quarter of an Egyptian pound rolled up but inside of it there's 200 Egyptian pounds so this is the other side of the coin someone who's actually given and he's hiding it well, subhanAllah, for it to stay between him and Allah. So when people see him putting in, they don't see a lot of money, they only see small currency. So subhanAllah, we have in this ummah, there's both sides of the spectrum. But subhanAllah, when, okay, I gave, subhanAllah, strange things. But subhanAllah, like the one I just told you, it's really infuriating. You know, you just don't know what to do with people like that. They have the ability to not only solve the problem for the sister, and just what he had in his hand, this cash that he had in his pocket, he could solve her problem for a year. This thing is, mashallah. And he's going through and he's giving me the smallest bill that he had. With pride too. He was really proud that he's doing something great, subhanAllah. So this is the condition of our ummah. They are people of good, alhamdulillah. But unfortunately, this is what the majority are doing nowadays. This is what the majority. Yeah.
If I may interrupt for a minute.
Yes.
Many folks actually don't really get any at all.
Yeah.
Thinking that you know they don't want to give their $5 not to make a difference. I consider that everybody should give whatever they can give to it because a lot of times people walk away without even $5.
You know the crazy part is that there are people that literally don't give anything. You never catch them putting something in the box. But yet, they're the first ones that come and voice their opinions and say, well, we have to change this, we have to change that, and we are giving our money. And I've seen online many messages, I've seen, you're giving your money? What, were you dreaming? Or, you know, you give your money last night, 2 o'clock in the morning? SubhanAllah. I mean, this is the way that our ummah is now. It's really, our ummah is saqima. It's really sick. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heal us, because the minute the hearts are healed, things will change completely, dramatically. Reminds us another story, I just remembered. You guys remember Hurricane Katrina, right? There's this Muslim brother who lost everything in that hurricane. They barely got out in time with his family and everything. His house, everything got wiped away. And with that, his job and everything. So he went to Texas, if I remember correctly. And immediately when they arrived to the city where they were going, he went to look for a masjid, and he went to the masjid. And in the masjid, they were doing a fundraising for a good cause. And they were calling people to give for the sake of Allah. This man had $600 to his name. It was in his pocket. It was $600. That's all he had. Him and his family. No job, no house, nothing. Doesn't know what he needs to do. They were saying to be for the sake of Allah. So he said, you know what? I'm not gonna let the shaitan, you know, play his games with me. Whatever I have. Because subhanAllah, when can you possibly say that? That you gave all of your money for the sake of Allah. It doesn't happen a lot. It doesn't happen a lot. So this man happened, he was in a situation where this is all he had. So he took it and he put it in the box. Said, you know, tawakkal ala Allah. And you know, that I, subhanAllah, that he's relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely. All of a sudden, a few minutes later, someone is pulling him from his toe. Hey, are you new here? He said, yeah, I just came from... said, can you help me? I need your help. He said, you know, brother so-and-so is right there, standing right there. He's in need of someone to help him in his store. And he's paying $1,500 a week. And he wants someone to start today. Are you available? Few minutes. It took only a few minutes. Allah replaced him with a good job, a job with a Muslim that pays really well. SubhanAllah. And there's so many situations where you see the ajaib, you see the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fulfillment of His promise. All we have to do is what? It's to believe, but not the Christian way. No offense to the Christians. You just have to believe. No, you believe and the good deeds have to follow. Believe and the good deeds have to follow, inshallah ta'ala. قال الله تبارك وتعالى مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل في كل سنبلة 100 حبة والله يضاعف لمن يشاء والله واسع عليم. The example, the parable of someone that gives for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the example of a grain. Look how tiny the grain is, subhanAllah, grain. You put it in the soil, what does it do? 7 ears full of grains come out. Every one of the 7 ears has what? 100 grains, ya Allah. That's why Allah Ta'ala multiplies them by 10, up to 700, to infinity. All depending on your sincerity and the way you did it and your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every ear that grows from that one grain has 100 grains. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies for whoever He wills. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encompassing of everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وهذا حديث عقبة بن عامر رضي الله عنه وصححه الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله تعالى قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الصدقة لتطفئ عن أهلها حر القبور. يا الله, the صدقة, the charity that you give for the sake of Allah, it will tame and bring down and extinguish the heat that people could have in their in their graves. You guys do know that some people will have heat in their graves. Some people will be burning in their graves. Look at Allah talks about Fir'aun. ذكرني بالآية النار يعرضون عليها غدوما وعشيا. Fire, they're burned with it in the morning and the evening. ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. And when the day of resurrection starts, then put the Fir'aun and his people in the worst of punishment. And this is one of the proofs that the punishment of the grave does exist, because a lot of people, even from the Muslims, say the punishment of the grave does not exist, subhanAllah. So a sadaqah will extinguish the fire and the heat in the graves. وَإِنَّمَا يَصَلِلُّ الْمُؤْمِنُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فِي ظِلِّ صَدَقَتِهِ. And verily, the believer seeks shade, he's shaded, subhanAllah, under his charity on the day of reckoning. And you might ask, he's shaded from what? What is he shaded from? What are we to seek shade from on the day of reckoning? Who can tell me? The sun. But would it be the sun that people go and enjoy? No, subhanAllah. We'd be so close to the heads. Burning and cooking the heads of people, wa'idhu billah. Your sadaqah would be a source of shade for you on that day. وفي حديث ابن عمر قال صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم هذا حديث متفق عليه لا حسد إلا في اثنتين لا حسد إلا في اثنتين. There is no envy except in two things. رجل آتاه الله القرآن فهو يتلوه آناء الليل وآناء النهار. يا الله اللهم اجعلنا منهم يا رب اجعلنا منهم. A man that was given the Quran, meaning the ability to memorize and to recite the Quran properly. This man, he recites the Quran during the night and during the day. ورجل آتاه الله مالا فهو ينفقه آناء الليل وآناء النهار. And a man that was given wealth, he spends it for the sake of Allah at night and during the day. SubhanAllah. وحديث أبي هريرة الذي رواه مسلم وأختم بهذا الحديث إن شاء الله تعالى حتى لا أطيل عليكم. إن شاء الله we'll close with this hadith. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم ما نقصت صدقة من مال ما نقصت صدقة من مال وما زاد الله عبدا بعفو إلا عزة وما تواضع أحد لله إلا رفعه الله. يا الله سبحان الله. هذه والله يعني تكتب بماء الذهب. Gems, jewels that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has given us. Again, like the same, the main hadith that we're explaining, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the charity will never decrease your wealth. Look how many times the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying this. And then every time that a servant is forgiving towards others, meaning that he was oppressed and he forgave, he was wronged and he forgave. Every time that a person is forgiving towards others, except that Allah Ta'ala will increase him in honor. And if Allah honors you, nobody can humiliate you, subhanAllah. And then he goes on to say that there's not a person that shows humility, that shows humbleness, except that Allah Ta'ala will raise his ranks. Isn't that what we're looking for? Wallahi, one of the most dangerous diseases that this ummah has been afflicted with is this disease of arrogance, wa'ayyadu billah. Today, more than any time before, because of a lot of factors, you'll see that that the ummah has been afflicted with this disease. You see people that are arrogant. And you look at them and you say, why? You wonder why? Because arrogance should have a reason. You know, Allah Ta'ala despises the arrogant ones. But his hatred and his dislike, this is the hadith of the Prophet, his dislike is a lot higher towards someone who is destitute, poor, and he's arrogant. وَكُرْهُ أَشَدْ لِلْفَقِيرِ الْمُتَكَبِّرِ قَالَ أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ لِأَنَّ لِلْعِدَامِ الدَّاعِ. The reason, because the reason is not there. If you're arrogant, it has to be based on something. You look at yourself in the mirror and you think, MashaAllah, there's nobody better looking than me. Or you feel like you're stronger than everybody else. Or you know, Allah gave you a lot of wealth, and that makes you feel like you're better than everyone. Or you've been given a lot of knowledge of the dunya, because someone who's given true knowledge of the akhirah would not be arrogant. So subhanAllah, people are arrogant nowadays based on nothing. There's no da'i, there's no reason for them to be arrogant, but yet subhanAllah, they carry themselves in a certain way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. نسأل الله لنا ولكم العفو والعافية. Allah ta'ala said that the arrogance is his upper garment and greatness is his lower garment. Whoever challenges Allah in those, Allah ta'ala will put him in the hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people that give for his sake without being afraid of poverty. And may He subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our honor by making us people that are forgiving and forbearing. And when they are oppressed, they, subhanAllah, they are patient. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you and I from the people of humility and keep us away from arrogance. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت استغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين وجزاكم الله خيرا.